This is the DigiLab 3D45, Dremel's latest 3D printer in their lineup. In today's video, we'll take a look at this full enclosed machine that is supposedly very easy to use. We'll test the mechanical and the thermal performance of the four materials that Dremel is selling for it, and why I think Dremel wasted a lot of potential on this printer. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. A couple of weeks ago, Dremel sent me their latest 3D printer for review. I actually unboxed and assembled it on a live stream and printed the first part, only semi-successfully. The 3D45 comes with everything you need to get started right out of the box. This includes the printer with a couple of accessories and two rolls of Dremel's filaments, nylon and eco ABS. After an assisted bed leveling procedure, it's ready to print the first models. Since Dremel is aiming towards the educational market, the printer is fully enclosed as well as CE certified and UL listed. Even though the machine looks big on first glance, it's really actually quite compact, but with a weight of almost 20 kilos, really heavy. The printing chamber is accessible via the front and top clear plastic doors that will activate a warning on the screen when they are opened, but prints will continue, thus a new print can't be started with open doors. The frame of the printer is mostly made out of injection molded parts, but the main parts of the frame are sheet metal aluminum. The print volume is 255x155x170mm, so quite a bit smaller than other printers, still, in my experience, plenty for most projects. The print bed is a removable piece of glass with a plastic frame that can be heated up to 100 degrees Celsius. The printer features a single nozzle direct extruder, which means that the gears that feed the filament to the nozzle sits right on the print bed and usually results in better printing performance since the filament path is stiffer. It features a filament runout sensor and can be heated up to 280 degrees Celsius. The material is loaded through a compartment on the side, which is just big enough for the 500 gram Dremel spools, and when I used my own materials, I had to utilize an external spool holder and a cardboard cover. The internal placement of the material has the benefit that more demanding materials like nylon will stay dry during the printing process, since they are in the warm and dry environment of the printing chamber, and it makes the printer more compact. The material is fed into the printhead from the top, where it has to make a tight bend, which can cause brittle materials to break. In the back of the printer, there is an activated charcoal filter that helps to reduce VOCs coming from the machine, though I would have liked to see a HEPA filter. The integrated camera helps to track the process of the build and will save time-lapse videos of your prints that are well lit via the integrated LED strips. The front of the printer features a resistive touchscreen display that worked well. The 3D45 has an internal power supply and is directly connected to mains via a standard cable. In terms of connectivity, you can connect the Dremel printer to your network via a LAN cable or the integrated Wi-Fi, which worked very well, even down in my basement. You can also load print files onto the machine using the USB port in the front. The other USB port is unfortunately useless and you can't connect to it via serial terminal. I opened the printer's electronics compartment and was pleasantly surprised by the great wiring job they did. The mainboard uses a 32-bit ARM Cortex M3 microprocessor that runs the printer, touchscreen and is responsible for the connectivity. Also very nice to see in a 3D printer is that all axes use Trinamic TMC5130 stepper motor drivers for better microstepping, less stepper noise and end-stop-less homing. The touchscreen is very simple and straightforward to use and lets you perform the basic tasks necessary and will even let you update the firmware if available. Unfortunately, besides the basic things, there can't be much more tuned than the basic settings and even adjusting the flow ratio is not possible. Good for a beginner, but frustrating for advanced users. The advanced mode also doesn't give you really much more options. Slicing your models, so creating the G-code that the machine can handle, can be done basically three different ways. First, there is the Dremel DigiLab software that can be downloaded for PC and Mac. This is Dremel's own version of Cura, which features a profile for all of their materials. Drag and drop your models in there, place them and select your profile. Advanced users also still have the possibility to tweak all the settings they like. DREMEL also officially supports Simplify 3D, another slicer with great support customizability, but that costs additional $150. Profiles for the printer are directly included, but have a bug in the end script that results in the print head crashing into your model at the end of a print if they are higher than 140mm. This can be fixed by just replacing that value with 170 though. The printer will also take G-code from any other slicers, and I actually found that a standard custom profile in the most current version of Cura prints even better than the results from Simplify 3D and Digilab. The G-code can then be transferred to the printer using a USB drive, or how I mostly ended up doing it, using the online interface. You can add your DREMEL printer to the DREMEL Print Cloud, which is a web service that lets you monitor and manage all of your prints online. At first, I had problems adding my printer, but after changing my country from Germany to USA, the token was shown. The Print Cloud doesn't only work from your home network, but also can be accessed from anywhere with blessing or curse at the same time. You can simply upload your G-code files here, start them on the printer, view the progress, and when the job is finished, you'll automatically get an email with a time-lapse video. DREMEL's Print Cloud also allows you to upload your 3D models directly and use the cloud slicing service, which simplifies the adjustable settings a lot and would actually allow you to use this printer even without a PC or Mac. Print quality using all three different methods was mostly similar, only my own Cura profile with 1 instead of 2mm of retraction produced even nicer results. Before we take a look at the print quality, let's take a look at the 4 different materials DREMEL is selling. There is PLA, PETG, Eco-ABS and Nylon, where a 500g roll of PLA sells for $25, the rest for $35. All rolls have RFID tags, which presets the printing parameters, but doesn't lock out internal filaments, because if you wait a couple of seconds during the loading process, you can also select custom parameters. Keep in mind that all profiles besides nylon will have the print chamber fan activated, so if you want to print materials like ABS, select nylon to get the chamber as hot as possible. So in order to find out which material is suitable for which application, I tested all 4 filaments for static strength and layer adhesion with these test hooks, impact strength using these ISOed coupons, and the thermal resistance with these bars I put in my oven. The results were very interesting. I have to say that I had to dry my roll of nylon in my food dehydrator overnight because it was unusable out of the box and always clogged. The nylon hook failed at 28kg, not because it broke, but because it flexed too much. Next was the PETG with 36kg, PLA with 41kg and Eco-ABS with 48kg of failure load. In terms of layer adhesion, the hooks that were printed standing were all able to bear around 50% of their lying counterparts, nylon even a bit more. So all in all, good and plausible results. Next was the impact test, where PETG was the weakest and absorbed the least amount of energy from the impact hammer. PLA and Eco-ABS showed similar results, and nylon was over 5 times tougher than the rest and even didn't fail all the way. The temperature test was interesting because PLA and Eco-ABS both failed at around 65 degrees Celsius, PETG at 85 degrees Celsius, and the nylon sample even didn't fail at 140 degrees Celsius and only became a little soft. But wait, why did the Eco-ABS sample already fail at 65 degrees Celsius? Well, I'd almost call this false advertising because Eco-ABS doesn't contain any ABS and is actually only a modified PLA, so doesn't share any features like high temperature and impact resistance with ABS. This is written in the frequently asked questions, but many don't know that. So in summary, I'd go for PLA for most of my prints because it's 30% cheaper than the other materials. Ditch the Eco-ABS because I didn't find any real benefits, and if you want to print something really tough that doesn't need to be totally rigid, then use nylon, but definitely dry it out to get its best performance and store it in a sealed bag. I also tried printing ABS, PC-ABS and Polymax polycarbonate, which all printed flawlessly, especially due to the enclosed print chamber that gets up to around 35 to 40 degrees Celsius if the chamber fan is not active. This is something not every printer can do, and also where the nozzle that can get up to 280 degrees Celsius does a very good job. Printing the flexible material polypropylene didn't seem to be an issue as well. I had some jams with other PLAs from time to time. In my opinion, this was due to heat creep issues, and when printing PLA, I usually let the doors open so the cold side of the hot end can get cooled properly. The print quality itself is great. Totally smooth surfaces, nice details, great overhang performance. The latest Christmas tree from Maker's Muse printed a bit stringy, but still almost flawlessly in the end. The acetone vapor smoothed owl that I printed from real ABS looks stunning. I also designed and printed some practical items like a nylon vibration motor mount for my filament extruder or these pipe brackets out of PETG that help me organize materials in my basement. Some might call me weird, but I find it oddly satisfying to see how much dirt our trusty vacuum robot collects each day. Since I vacuum out the dustbin to get the filter clean again, I designed and iterated on a custom nozzle to remove the dust the most efficient way from the lamella. This part was also printed from nylon, which makes it very robust. Let's summarize the results a little. What bothered me a bit was that even though the printer is fully enclosed, it gets kind of loud during printing, especially when the chamber fan is running. This is why I actually ended up moving it from my office into my basement, so that it doesn't bother me that much. This is how it compares to the Prusa Mark 2.5 and a CR10S. It's quieter than a CR10S, but quite a bit louder than a Prusa Mark 2.5. What I have to give the 3D45 is that it's totally silent when turned on, but not printing. The printer is easy to use, but too simplified for an advanced user as I am, and it sometimes really bothered me that there wasn't a simple way to adjust settings during the print. Yes, the leveling procedure is assisted, but the nozzle gap needs to be adjusted later, for which you have to stop your print. That's ridiculous. In theory, this printer is open source, but practically you need to rely on Dremel for new firmware updates because you can't simply flash another OS on it. Even though you can use other materials, the small spool compartment and the jamming problems using some other materials kind of pushes you to buy Dremel materials. Still, using these materials, besides the moisture problem in the nylon, worked great. The print volume is not the biggest, but still sufficient for my projects. I had bad adhesion problems from time to time, and one of the reasons is that PLA, for example, uses only a 35 degrees bed and the temperature distribution is not really that great. I ended up using a printer fix spray for all PLA projects and different types of magic goo for all of my more advanced projects. For PLA, I also upped the bed temperature to 55 degrees, which then really makes it necessary to open the doors during printing, otherwise you'll get heat creep problems. Besides all of these negative points, the 3D45 is a really sexy looking machine, well built, and I'm very happy that they didn't use the old cutter scheme anymore. It's really easy to set up and easy to use, so even a beginner should be able to work with this machine. The print cloud worked flawless, and I ended up using it for 95% of my prints, especially since the printer was down in my basement. The print quality is great, and it can't only be used for aesthetic prints. With its enclosure, it's not only suitable if you have kids around, but even allows you to work with technical materials like ABS, nylon, or polycarbonate. I talked about wasted potential in the beginning because I think this printer would not only be well suitable for educational purposes, but also for advanced makers. In order to fulfill the needs that I have with such a machine, I'd really, really like to see the guys at Dremel work on the printer software. Please give us a real advanced mode where I can change temperatures and flow rates on the fly. Give us access to the chamber fan and maybe add a HEPA filter to make it even a bit more safe. If this would be possible, I could recommend this printer also to serious makers without restrictions. Unfortunately, at the moment, I'd really need to modify this printer a little to make it better suitable for my uses. I can't do anything about the software, but I'd add a proper charcoal and HEPA filter to the machine and add an adjustable flow restrictor to the chamber so that I would also be able to run it and extract fumes when printing ABS and PC. I'd probably also add a hardened steel nozzle like the one from MicroSwiss to enable me to print carbon fiber and other filled materials. So, would I recommend the Dremel 3D45 that usually sells for around $1,600? With its safety functions, filters and enclosure, it's well suited for the educational market. But if you don't have any kids around and primarily want to print PLA, then I wouldn't go for the Dremel because the enclosure and the small print volume will rather hinder you and the price tag is quite steep. If you are a serious maker looking for an enclosed printer who wants to print functional parts, then this machine should be well suited if you are okay with constantly voiding your warranty and coping with the simplified software that hopefully will be improved in the future.
So this was my take on the Dremel 3D45. What do you guys think about this rather expensive machine? Let me know down in the comments, and if you found this video helpful, please leave a like and subscribe to the channel if you are new. As a disclaimer, I got this printer free of charge from Dremel, but will have to return it after this review. Links to the product and the models I printed are, as always, down in the description, and if you'd like to support this channel, why not become a Patreon? Thanks for watching, auf Wiedersehen, and until next time!